Hello learners, I, Dr. Manisha Vadva from Department of Education, Aditi Mahavidyalay, University of Delhi, welcome you to this NIOS studio. Today, our topic of discussion is Assessment Tools in EVS, Characteristic and Selection. Assessment is not meant to compare and rank children against each other or against some fixed norms, but it helps teachers to analyze how well each child is able to perform, to track his or her progress, and to provide necessary feedback to ensure improvement. EVS learning objectives include cognitive, affective, and psychomotor behavior. Therefore, multiple assessment techniques are needed for evaluating the outcomes. Objective of today's session is to explain assessment techniques which can be beneficial for EVS, to describe, select, and use different tools for assessment. Today in this session, we will be discussing tools like test, observation schedule, checklist, rating scales, audio-video recording. In brief, and there will be separate sessions in detail on all these assessment tools. For any assessment process, it is a long process. It is not just giving a question paper and conducting on students. First, as a teacher, you need to decide the assessment tool or technique. What kind of assessment you want to do with children? How old children are? What are your objective of that particular assessment? Accordingly, you decide a tool. After that, deciding a tool, you prepare the tool, then you conduct the tool. After conducting the tool, you collect your observations and then you record information. After that, you report that information to children and their parents, and this is the assessment of learning, and then you give them feedback for further enhancement in learning. So you see that assessment is a continuous process, starting from objectives to going to further learning. So it is, I will say, that one complete cycle. Assessment tool provides information which is used to determine a planned learning outcome has been achieved or not. You have to see whether my objective of this class is achieved or not, and this can be done only after assessment. Assessment tools are relevant for EVS are observation schedule, checklist, rating scale, audio or video recording. The tool should match with the content of teaching learning. For example, in our earlier discussion on field visits, we have seen one example of visit to a stable. If you had organized a field visit to a stable for studying horses, how will you assess that field visit? So, presentation of group work will be one assessment tool. There can be multiple tools. According to your class, your children, and your objectives, you can decide the tool. So, presentation can be one kind of assessment tool which can be used. So, in that visit to a stable, children can present their group reports and you can assess their presentation and group reports. In another example, for a field visit to a school park where children have studied plants, you can give them an observation schedule to fill, and wherein they can mark what are different kinds of flowers they have seen, what is the color of flower, or how many petals, or any other special feature of for that flower. So this kind of observation schedule can be used to assess a field visit to a school park. For a theme of travel, you can give newspaper clippings, and after that, children can be expected to write and their creative expression, either written expression or can be oral expression, can be used to assess children. So you see that there is, one is the method of teaching, which we call teaching learning method. Other is method of assessment, which we call tool or technique of assessment. So one, you have to decide about the teaching method, and then you have to decide about the tool or technique for assessment. So tool and technique for assessment is dependent on method and in turn dependent on the objective. So this is one complete cycle. What are the features of an assessment tool? Assessment tool should be valid. It should be reliable. It should be balanced. Assessment tool is valid if its results are appropriate and useful for making decision about an aspect of children's achievement. Assessment tool will be reliable if it accurately and consistently evaluates a student's performance. Assessment tool will be balanced if it addresses the key learning outcome and key learning ideas. Beginning in any assessment tool, always begin with simpler concepts. For example, if you decided to make a question paper only or a test paper only, begin your test paper with simple questions. Why simple questions? Because simple question will help learners to overcome their text anxieties, to overcome their nervousness. Do you remember that you yourself were very anxious when you appeared for your class 10th board exam or class 12th board exam? So there is anxiety related to test, there is anxiety related to examination. So if you give simple questions to students to begin with, they will have confidence in themselves and they will overcome their nervousness and anxiety. And this will also give them time to complete their task. You have to remember that when you are giving a test to a primary school child, it is not a speed test. You are not checking their efficiency. You are checking their understanding. You are checking their reflection. You are checking their perspective building. And you are checking their experiential learning. So in this, there is no need for a long, lengthy test. So you have to remember that you as teacher need not prepare any speed test and also need not give very informative questions. Then when you prepare a test, always try it out. Try out the timing. A test should be neither too long nor too short. If it is a half an hour test or a 1 hour test, question should be according to the duration of the test. Duration should be appropriate. It should be tried out on a sample. Sample of maybe 2 students, maybe 3 students, so that you know that the test is not too short or not too long for that particular age group. A good assessment tool should include both direct and indirect items. Let's see what are direct items. Direct items, they demonstrate learning. Direct methods are objective type of test, essay test, presentation or classroom assignments. These items, they test knowledge, they test content. They are generally based on information. For example, let's say, list different ways in which rice should be cooked. So this can be a direct item. You are asking a question where children from their memory are able to respond to a question. So there are direct questions in a test. Direct questions are also important because they can be conducted to a large group. If you have to assess 5,000 students, if you have to assess 1 lakh students, then generally direct questions are asked. Then we come to the indirect questions or indirect items. These indirect questions, they give opportunities to learner to reflect on their learning. They give opportunities to learners to apply their learning in a given situation. Indirect methods can be surveys, projects, experiment. For example, from the NCERT textbook, Chuskit could reach school at last. Do you think she may have faced some difficulty inside the school? What kind? If you were Chuskit's friend, how would you help her? Do you remember this chapter? You have read it in your class 5 NCERT textbook, EVS textbook, which says Chuskit goes to school and where the whole community work together and build a road so that Chuskit can go to school on a wheelchair. So this question is given in the textbook. So it is not a direct question. One need to think about it. One need to reflect. So now I hope you can differentiate between direct and indirect items. You need to think carefully that about the learning outcomes you wish to measure, that only determine the kind of test. If your objective is to check how much students have remembered, then probably you will ask questions which are information or content based. The type of items best suited for measuring these outcomes. The range of difficulty of test items should vary. One should have simple questions, one should have questions at medium difficulty level, and one could have questions with higher difficulty level, so that you can see that all kinds of questions are there in the test. There are also limitations to all tests. There is always a format and layout of the test. And scoring and analysis should be done carefully. You need to check all questions carefully, and then you need to analyze what kind of questions your students are able to do and where you as teacher need to focus more. So only after assessment you can also, it is not only assessment of children, it is also your own assessment where you can see that which are the areas which need more attention. There are certain oral techniques for assessment. Oral techniques are different kinds of techniques where students have an opportunity to speak or to present themselves orally. Certain examples are debate. For example, is fast food good for health? Discussion, you can organize discussions on ideas like alternatives to petrol. You can organize quizzes, you can organize theater, you can organize presentations. You see that in all these techniques, the students have to do something orally. They have to present themselves, they have to give answers to the question, they have to express their opinion, they have to participate in a discussion or a debate. So these oral techniques will help anybody to present themselves. So some students are very good in oral techniques, some are not. So it is always good to have combination of assessment tools. Oral techniques test both the knowledge of the subject and communication skills. They are important for development of vocabulary and reasoning power. Reasoning power, you see that one is participating in a debate or a discussion, how to counter that point or how to supplement that point. So reasoning power developed by participating in such methods. Then oral techniques provides immediate feedback, which allows the student to learn as they are tested. Oral technique, a large number of children can be examined at one time. When different students are presenting in groups, you can have presentation of more students. So a large number of students can be assessed at that time. But there are also limitations to oral techniques. Examination of detailed knowledge and critically thinking skills may not be done effectively. More time is required for planning and organization. And one of the very important factor is that it does not generate a written record. If a student asks you, why have you given me A plus, not O outstanding in this presentation? And if you have not taken any record, written record, you will not be able to answer that question. So for any oral technique, you as a teacher need to write about the student's presentation or student's presentation or a debate or a discussion or their performance, so that later on you know that why you have given that student a particular mark or a particular grade. Then another limitation of oral technique is it is not good for qualitative assessment. Then we come to the written techniques. There are different types of questions which are asked in written techniques. The most popular one is the objective type. In objective type, there are different kinds of questions. One is a multiple choice question. In a multiple choice question, for a given question, there are multiple responses. Out of those multiple responses, one has to choose which is a right response. So out of four, the pattern which we follow, that out of four, one response is correct. So student has to choose which response is correct. Then another type of objective item is a true-false item, where a statement is given and student has to say whether it is a true or a false. In some cases, it is also extended in a sense that you have to correct the false statement. In some situations, one has to explain that why it is false. So these are the extension of these objective type items. Then there are fill in the blank, which are also called one word. In this, one has to answer the given, one has to fill that given blank. For example, name any shrub growing in your school campus. So this is a one word kind of a question. Then third type is a match the following. There is a column A and there is a column B. For example, in column A, food items, name of the vegetables are given. In column B, parts of the plant are given. So you have to match name of the vegetable to the part of the plant. So this is called match the following, and you must have seen various such questions in the given NCERT textbook. Then going further, after objective types, one word and match the following, we have short answer questions. These are the questions which require short answers. Short answers in one sentence or in two sentences. Like I have taken an example from NCERT textbook of class 5 from the chapter Experiments with Water. The question is, what difference do you see in the water with salt and the water with chalk powder after keeping it for some time? So if you recall, in that given chapter, after experiments with water, this question was asked. So students, they are expected to answer this question, and they can only answer this question if they have seen that experiment. So though it is a short question, but it is not based on information. Then we come to the fifth category and the last category, which is essay type. These are more descriptive questions. These are questions where one is expected to write more. Another example, which I have taken from class 5 NCERT textbook from the chapter No Place for Us. Question is that people also shift from one place to another when they get transfer in their jobs. How do they feel then? So this is a question which gives an opportunity to learner to think about how people feel when they get transferred. And you can extend this question in a situation that how girls feel when they get married and go to another place. So you can link it to other concepts. Such questions give you an insight of what children are thinking. These are some advantages of written techniques. One is that it gives an independent expression of views. If you ask an essay type question, children can express their views independently depending upon their own experience. Then you can record the achievement of the individual student. As students have given written responses, you have their answers with you. So this is the record of their achievement. Then these kinds of written techniques also assess their expression, also assess their writing ability and their personality. These can be administered to a large group. These are certain limitations of written test. Like objective type or multiple choice questions, they take lot of time in preparing. They take lot of time in construction. Then these tests do not test attitude, skill or personality. And I will say that one of the biggest disadvantages is that such questions encourage guessing. Even without knowing the answer, I can tick anyone and my answer can be, you know, it's an absolute guess, then also it can be right. So such questions encourage guessing. Limitation of essay type is that you can only ask few essay type items in a test, and there is also subjectivity in checking. Let's take an example of a question. For example, what should be my diet? This is a question. How will you assess it? So a teacher in a class, she's planned a discussion on this topic, what should be my diet. For this, she asked children to collect pictures of their role model. Teacher looked through the collection of pictures, and as expected, what will you expect from your students? Obviously, they will either collect picture of film actors or actress and or cricket players. These are the popular role models in India. So as expected, film actors and cricket players were found to be the most popular role models. So this was an opportunity she got, and then she organized a group discussion. For that, she asked some questions like, how is diet of a film actor different from that of a cricket player or a bodybuilder? Students organized themselves in small groups. Different groups worked on different tasks. A group of students gathered information from books, health magazines, newspaper about dietary recommendations. Another group surveyed different people in the community and collected information regarding popular notions about diet. Another group interviewed nurses, doctors, dietitians, and coaches to find about the need of different type of diets for different people. Each group collected relevant information. Students also kept a record of their own diet, that is what they eat and how their diet is different from different groups. So you see that different groups collected information on different aspects. Students used tables and graph to represent their collected information. They developed a meaningful relationship between the task performed by a person and her or his diet. They understood that diet of a person is dependent upon the function they perform. So, trigger by a teacher helped them to develop an understanding of how diet is linked to the work. And you see that this is an absolutely unconventional way of assessment. This kind of assessment is done only through group discussion. And teacher kept a record of each group, that what each group has done, and after that teacher can assess them. In the light of their findings, then students made generalization about their diet. Students realize that they should reconsider what they are eating and they need to change their eating habits. And finally, students displayed their results of this task on the school board, and other children from other classes can see what they have done, and other children of the school also learn from their experiences. Now let's summarize what we have done in this session. As a teacher, I will suggest you to spend adequate time in developing a test, because that is the beginning. When you are developing a test, you should first decide what kind of test you want to do, whether you want to do an oral test or a written test. If you want to do an oral test, then what different kinds of tests you can choose. If you want to do a written test, then what kind of questions do you want to ask? So when you decide about the oral and written test, after that, you need to see the duration of test, whether you want to conduct a half an hour test or a 1 hour test, or you want to go in for some other kind of assessment tool. You have to be very careful that any assessment tool or technique should be in accordance with the learning objective, because learning objective, they guide the teaching method. Learning objectives, they guide the assessment tool, because assessment is not only of the students. Assessment is also yours. Assessment is also of your own teaching method. You need to avoid ambiguous questions. Questions should be clear. Questions should not have double meanings. These should be clear statements which primary children can understand. Then you should have clear directions. Avoid all unclear directions. Avoid any kind of vague scoring criteria. It is always advised to have a scoring criteria before starting the correction of any test, correction of any answer sheet. So if you have scoring criteria well prepared in advance, there will be no objectivity. And there are always scoring criteria for everything. It is not only test. Scoring criteria of a presentation, scoring criteria of a performance, scoring criteria of a written expression, scoring criteria of a drawing. So all tools and techniques should have well prepared scoring criteria, and it should not be vague. These tools should be used in combination. You should use variety of tools in classroom so that you are able to do a meaningful assessment of children. For instance, if you have done a written test in term 1, you can do a oral test in term 2, you can do a presentation in term 3, you can do a group discussion in term 4. So you will see that by using a variety of tools in assessment, you are able to assess students on different aspects of learning. As a teacher, our purpose is not only to check their content knowledge. As a teacher of EVS, our objective is also to assess their ideas, their assess their skills, assess their personalities, assess their, I will say that, assess this, how they are developing the skills of reasoning, thinking, are they reflecting. So if I am using variety of tools, then I will be able to have a clear picture of different learners in my classroom. So I will say that this session on assessment tools and technique, you will be able to make sense that there are different tools and techniques for assessment which are guided by your learning objectives, and as a teacher, a variety of tools and techniques should be used in classroom. Thank you, and we will see you again in the next session.